Hi, this is Chetan Nayak, the creator and developer of BrewToTail. BrewToTail is a highly customizable command and control center which can be used for red team or adversarial simulation activities. The video series that I'm starting today will contain everything ranging from creating listeners, payloads, to moving laterally and further post-exploitation activities. So we'll take a look at the different parts of BrewToTail. There are a total of three different parts, the first being the team server, which you will be seeing right in front of you right now. The second part is the commander, which is the graphical user interface. And the third part is basically the payload. There's also an Android handler, which we'll take a look at later on. For the time being, we'll get started with the listener. So the listener comes in either of two flavors. The first one is the ARM architecture, and the second one is basically the Linux architecture. We'll get started with the Linux architecture. There's not any difference between either of them. However, we'll be taking a look at the Linux one since my base system is Linux right now. Whenever you execute your core server, you will get three different options, the Boomerang, the Retail, and the update mode. So you can either execute Boomerang to start a SOX proxy server, you can execute Retail to execute the core command and control center, or you can use the hyphen update option to check for updates from the brewtotail.com server. So let me just maximize it for the time being. So when you execute this with the hyphen retail option, you will get a few different options here. Hyphen A is basically to provide the initial core administrator. Whenever you create a new handler by default, there will always be a single user that's basically the administrator. And after that, you can connect actually add multiple warmongers to that. Warmongers are nothing but users which can connect to the server, and there is no limitation on the licensing of the part of how many different operators or how many different warmongers can connect to a specific server. We have the hyphen B option, which can read a badges configuration from a JSON file in case of a crash or something else. We'll take a look at this later on. This is just something that is there so that in case there's the bug or something else, or then you would need a way where you might want to restore all your lost badges which were connected back to your server. So we'll take a look at this later on. Usually there should never be a scenario when you would have to use this, but just in case, there's no harm in having an option to restore your badges over here. You have an hyphen C option which takes in a configuration, which we'll take a look at later on again. You have the hyphen E option, where we can go ahead and provide the encryption key. Whenever a payload connects back to the server, it will encrypt the whole data and send it back to the server in an encrypted format. It will basically be in a post request itself, and you can encrypt the whole information within a given encryption key. The encryption type is basically a mixture of AES as well as RSA, which was custom written by me. You have the hyphen H option, where you can go to specify the IP address and the port of where your handler would start. This is where your graphical user interface would connect over a WebSocket and fetch responses or send responses back to your command and control center. You have the hyphen P option for the user's password or the operator's password, SC for the SSL certificate, SK for the SSL key, and hyphen SP to generate a sample configuration file and dump it directly to disk. We are not concerned with this right now since we are not writing a C4 profile. We'll take a look at that later on. So right now, we'll just simply start a standalone command and control center. We can provide the hyphen A option, the username, let's say it's admin. Hyphen P, let's say the password is admin@123, for example. Hyphen E, you can leave this if you don't want to add a custom encryption key. It will by default create its own. So I'll leave this for the time being. Hyphen H, where I can specify the host colon port where my handler would start. If you want to listen on 0.0.0.0, and if you're lazy like me, you can just type :8443 or any port that you want. Or if you have a specific IP, you can type that as well. I'll just type :8443 where my handler would start at the time being. Hyphen P would be the password, which I've already specified. Hyphen SC for the certificate file, and hyphen SK for the key file. In a real-life scenario, you would basically be using Let's Encrypt key and certificate or something else that you might have purchased for your red team operations. Don't use the one that I have specified over here This is a stealth sign certificate, and there are high chances that you would get caught if you are dealing with any sophisticated environment. So once you start the server, you can see that the communication encryption key was automatically created. Our next portion is to start the commander. And whenever you extract the package of BrewTTL, you would see a commander-runme option. So it's always better to run this if you're using an Ubuntu or any other operating system. If you're using Kali, then you can directly go into the commander folder and run the commander file by installing a few dependencies, which you can find in a shell script within your core RTL package. We will take a look at that later on. For the time being, we'll go ahead and run commander-runme, which will start the commander graphical user interface for us. This is how the UI would look like. Your configuration of your server will be stored in a local conf file. We are not concerned with that right now. I'll just start the server. I'll just connect back to the server that we created. And this is how your graphical user interface should look like.